welcome to the Choral Conductors Colloquium, Volume 1, Lecture 5. My name is Raul Dominguez, and I will be your host and moderator. Before we begin, please note, this webinar is being recorded and will be posted in the near future on our YouTube channel. All of our past lectures are now live on our YouTube channel. The University of Colorado Boulder is now offering credit and certificates through their Department of Continuing Education for those who attend all 5 lectures. Details on how to apply can be found in previous and future colloquium e-blasts. For those applying, please be aware your deadline is in 10 days, August 15. Today's lecture will be 1 hour long, followed by a 15-minute question and answer session. Please submit your questions at any time using the Q&A button found in your toolbar. Priority will be given to questions about today's topic. Questions submitted to the chat room will not be considered. Thank you to our sponsors, Sue Baer, Jeffrey Nytch and the Entrepreneurship Center for Music, and faculty sponsor, Director of Choral Studies, Dr. Gregory Gentry from the University of Colorado Boulder. Now, it is my sincere privilege to welcome the Artistic Director of the Cantabile Youth Singers and the Music Director of the Symphony Silicon Valley Chorale, Elena Sharkova.
Thank you so much, Raul, and hello, everybody. And so wonderful to be here. And I cannot see you, or only see Raul, of course, but I can feel the wonderful presence of my colleagues. And get ready for a fast and furious 1 hour of blasting through 1,200 years of Russian choral music. So it will be fast, but the point of my lecture and my goal for today is to let you discover some of Russian music that you didn't know even existed, and also to make you more excited and less anxious about performing Russian music. And all of the scores that we will be looking at and actually are available either through Musica Russica or through Carl Fischer. So all the music that you will be hearing today, you can actually get the scores and perform. So let's begin by just sort of define what are we talking about? What is Russian music? And here for you, I have a map, which in this sort of salmon color shows you the Russian Federation as it is now. And this is not the way, of course, Russia was centuries before, and it's not actually even what it used to be in the 20th century. So if you see, you cannot see my cursor, but you can see that there is to the left, the in other colors, yes, we are showing republics. Thank you, Raul. Yes, we're showing republics that used to be the countries now, used to be republics of the Soviet Union. So if you move north, there is Lithuania, Estonia, and Latvia. You move down, there is Belarus, and Ukraine, and Moldova, right next to the Black Sea. And then also, as you move again south, you will see Georgia, Armenia, and Azerbaijan. And again, moving east now, east and south, there's the huge territory that is Kazakhstan, and then Turkmenistan, Tajikistan, and Uzbekistan, all of those Stan countries that, again, used to be part of the Soviet Union. And the reason I'm talking about this is because I'm not going to cover today music that was produced in Soviet Union, because this is a different lecture, just definitely different topic. So Soviet Union existed until 1991, and all of these republics, they produce quite a lot of music because of the establishment of conservatories and other cultural institutions to train musicians and certainly train composers too. So if we move to the next one, next slide, please. And that is really exciting. And this is how it all started. So this pink plop on the map, and I hope you can make it bigger so you can see. And you know, where does the word Rus even coming, and how did it establish? So these were, of course, all the Slavs, you know, to all the way to the east and to the south. These were all Slavs, Slavic people. And whenever you go to Middle Ages, you know, look for Vikings. There's always something with Vikings. Vikings were looking for new routes to connect with Byzantine, as you can see down there below the Black Sea, and connect to the Mediterranean through the Bosphorus canal. And so they found, Raul, if you could trace it from the Gulf of Finland. See the Gulf of Finland there? Yes, from through the Gulf of Finland, you see all those rivers, and there's all those rivers, they take you down, 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 you can see into the Black Sea. So these were the trade routes, sort of like the Silk Roads of the Vikings. And they were very important to them because that was trade, all kinds of trade. And so in order to have this route to them, they actually conquered quite a few people and established their trading posts. So there's not much below the Gulf in Finland and the big lake there called Ladoga, you see a city called Novgorod. You're almost there, Raul. Yes, it's right there. And Novgorod, so that was the first city that you can say, this is the beginning of Russia as we know it. And then if you move down, Raul, you will find Kiev, which is now the capital of Ukraine. And that was the second city that they established. So when we talk about Rus, and by the way, Rus is a name of one of the tribes of Vikings. And so the country we now called Russia used to be Old Rus. And Rus means just simply, it's a last name of a Viking tribe. So now that we established that, so what was happening? What was happening, of course, this is still pagan times. This is pre-Christianity. So lots of folk music was going on, and folk singing was with this instrument that you can see on the right, and it's called gusli, and it's sort of like a lute kind of instrument. And what we have from that period, left over culturally, is those epic ballads, of course, talking about the princes and the fights, the battles and things like that. So let's move on, and let's move to the time of pre-Christianity. So the Prince Vladimir was also looking for good trade and was looking for commerce. And what he did is he decided that it would be nice to side with one of the religions. So he decided to actually have a religion, monotheistic religion for Russia, and they adopted Eastern Orthodoxy. And so with Eastern Orthodoxy, this is an important moment. They not only they brought Greek language Orthodox Christianity traditions, but they also brought the Byzantine chant and Cyrillic alphabet. And so there were two brothers. We don't know whether they were actually brothers or they were just brothers monks. They were called Cyril and Methodius, and through them we have the Bible and we have the Cyrillic alphabet. And of course, Cyrillic alphabet is called after Cyril, brother Cyril. And so what I would like you to hear this time is the Byzantine chant as it came to Russia around that time. If you could play this, is it here?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so that's what religious chanting was in the beginning of the religious life of Russia. And so what happens, of course, the folk melodies, so the melos changes, and from all of this very Mediterranean sounding, very Eastern sounding music, it becomes more Russian, and another chant is being introduced, is actually being created, and it's called znameni. And znamen means new, and so it's a pneumatic chant. And Old Church Slavonic, which is, as you know, is not the same as Russian. And that's the language that is now used only in liturgical services. It's starting to replace the Greek. And so what it really is, it's a combination of Russian or Slavic languages, or Slavic language and Greek. So it's a very interesting situation. So we've got two different languages created into one. Well, so then what happens, we have this 300 years of Mongol invasion, and that it comes from, you know, we call, usually in the historical books, in history books, it would be called Mongol period or Mongol invasions. But there were Tartars, and same words for Tatars, Khazars, Pechenegs, that all of the Eastern tribes and princes coming in. So it began with Genghis Khan in 1220 and lasted over 300. So it was 300 years. And so that was the time that was really everything kind of stopped, and there was no progress, there was no advancement, because there was just a constant coming of this destructive forces. And I put some scary pictures there, you know, of Mongols going through Russian land. And this is one of the pictures that sort of shows that originally Russians were very much of a Viking type people. And they say that it's the 300 years of Mongol invasion, where there was a lot of mixing of the blood, and so the Russians became shorter and eyes are closer to the nose, and so all of this, just a very interesting transition also of people. Well, let's move on. And so we're coming to a new period, is when Russia becomes not just a bunch of different states. Ivan the Fourth was the first czar, and Ivan the Fourth, or Ivan the Terrible, was the first prince that proclaimed himself the czar of all Russia. And so that was a unification of Russia. And look at him, you know, isn't he soft and fuzzy there? He actually, if you translate it, it's not really terrible. The right translation would be the awesome, but I'm sure he was terrible as well. So what's important? So the one Ivan before him did something very, very important, and he established himself. He actually decided to have a choir. And the legend says that it wasn't just, you know, he decided to have a choir. Actually, some scouts from Ivan III went to Vatican, went to Rome, and heard this incredible choir that the Pope had. And then when they told the Tsar that look, Pope has a choir and you don't, of course, that Ivan said, well, I want one, but much better than the Pope's. And so they said they're very, very high tenors. And they said, well, my tenors will be higher than the Pope's. And by golly, my basses will be lower than the Pope's. And so that really was, this is where really the whole craze, or, you know, obsession, if you will, with low basses started. And it's just amazing, as someone who, you know, I lived half of my life in Russia, and I was actually at a certain point a manager of a professional choir, and it was in my duty to find those low basses. And it's amazing, it's a tradition, they're being cultivated, and every generation would have one of those incredible low basses, and they're very, very expensive. You usually hire by note. So I know by note or by bottles of beer. The reason I wanted to show you these pictures is, of course, on the left, it's the Hagia Sophia in Constantinople. And then on the right, this is the modern Moscow, and it's at St. Basil Cathedral and the Kremlin in the back. And so what's happening, of course, you know this part of the history is in 1543, Constantinople falls to the Ottoman Empire. And so that Byzantine Empire is starting to truly fall apart. And Russia becomes the biggest country that is Orthodox, and it just self-proclaims to be the leader of Eastern Orthodoxy. Moscow was a tiny hamlet, but because it was it's a very good position on the route, one of the trade routes, it becomes a city and becomes the capital of Russia in 1547. So let's move on again. So here we've got this 17th century. Can you move one more slide, please, Raul? Thank you very much. And so we are now in 17th century, and it's the times of trouble. So the dynasty that we had before was called the Ruriks. Russians actually only had two dynasties, not like the English. One was called the Ruriks, and they were literally Rurik was a Viking name, and it was succeeded then by the, what their name is, well, Romanovs, Romanovs, and then their dynasty began actually in 1613 after quite a lot of imposters. And if you know of Mussorgsky opera Boris Godunov, it's all about that. It's all about not having an heir of the Tsar that died, and then just going through all kinds of people who are coming in and saying, I am the lost son, or I am the lost brother. And so it was just, we call them the times of trouble. And so of course, you know, any big event like this in Russian history, we've got an opera about that. And so, and again, the important part with Romanov's dynasty is that it brings westernization to Russia, because they invite a lot of people from Western Europe to be a part of the commune. But what I would like to before we go into that whole westernization of Russian culture, I would like to play for you to hear this beautiful Znamenny chant. So remember, we're already quite a few centuries, and this is a really where that Byzantine chant that you heard becomes very different. It truly becomes a Russian sounding line. Could you play that, please? Sound to me, this sounds like a folk song, but actually, you know, I forgot to play one more. I apologize. So if we go back to the 17th century, sorry, back to the future, and then of course all of you know the beautiful number 6 from Rachmaninoff's Vespers, Bogorodice Deva Radujsya, and it is a chant, right? So this is a chant harmonized brilliantly by Rachmaninoff. But I wanted you to hear this. This says Ave Maria here in the presentation, and it is an Ave Maria, Bogorodice Devo. But what you will hear is the original chant, but performed here by actually a classmate of mine, Vladimir Miller, who is an octavist, who is the basso profundo. So have a listen. So that's the one that Rachmaninoff sets. So that's the one. Just think about it. You could take that, you know, you can take that chant straight out of the chant book and have it as a part of your concert. I think that would be brilliant. Okay. All right. So let's move to the 17th century continuation of it, back to the future. The church is experiencing the schism. So the czars, who was also the head of the church, decided that he would like to reform the church and have it more aligned with the Greek orthodoxy. And then, of course, there are always those who would like to stay as it is. And it was quite a huge event in Russia. There were really hundreds of people, many of them nobles, who did not want to have any reforms in the church. And then this is how we have a new sort of movement in the church for the first time. And these are the old believers. These are the ones who decided that we were not going to change anything. We would like to preserve religion as it is. And one of the things that they didn't want to take at all, which were the musical developments. And what is interesting about this is they actually moved away from the western part of Russia. They moved all the way to Siberia, and they were just sort of disappeared in the woods, very, very often being completely secluded from other people. But also interestingly, they continued moving, and they moved all the way to Alaska. And now the biggest communities of old believers are actually in Oregon. And the Russian, very often Russian researchers go to Oregon to study the traditions of these old believers. And they preserved a lot of music in its original form. So you see here a picture of old believers there on the right, a jolly bunch. Okay, so again, so what's happening with the chant? So remember, this is orthodoxy, which means that only composers, only people who are trained to be to write religious music can actually write religious music. So anything that is a new development comes very slowly, because there is no, okay, why don't we try this? Why don't we try that? Everything has to fit into the rules of the church. But a very interesting thing comes, and it's called line singing. And it's sort of pre-harmonization. And this is the three lines. They're not even in the same book. They're not even written in the same book, but three lines, each one of them is a variation of the main melody, sort of like the tenor, but they move independently. And whatever happens between them harmonically sort of happens by chance, but not really. So I would like you to listen to this. Just a few years ago, there was a recording of this line singing tradition.
Oh, no.
I think it's glorious. I think it's just absolutely magical. And of course, we're still in male choruses, right? Most music is written for tenors and basses. And another thing here is, if you ever heard Georgian music, Georgian polyphony, it's very much like that. It reminds, and of course, Georgian polyphony is something that I can talk about for days. It's just so glorious. And by the way, again, Musica Russica has great scores printed, and so does, Earth Songs as well. And I've done it with Chanticleer, I've done it with Seraphic Fire. It's a showstopper, besides being just really very profound. Okay, so then we just got done with Mongols, but then, so that side is clear, but then we get the Poles and Lithuanians. They're coming in, and so what are they bringing? They're bringing the sounds and the sides of the Western Catholicism. And there is just immediate interest, because they come and they stay, you know, and then there's immediate interest to organs and orchestras, which are not allowed at all in Russia in the religious music. But actually the religion is so strong and sort of, it's rough, you know, it's just nothing that the folk music sort of exists, but nobody pays attention, but there's nothing in the house of a noble, only sacred music can sound, nothing worldly. So now, again, what is happening is, as we continue into the 18th century, where Western civilization comes more and more and more into Russia, we start seeing composers from Italy and from the Low Countries, they're coming. And so Russia becomes a place where music from other cultures is being consumed, not yet participated in, which means that the composers are brought in, but also the singers and then the musicians, and certainly not composing in that style. But because several composers actually get trained in Italy, they come back, and then Lithuania sometime, and they come back, and they come back to write for the Russian liturgical services music that sounds like that Baroque concerto, or a Baroque motet, or Renaissance motet. And it's really an incredible combination of a Russian melos and the technique and structure of the Western music. So what I want to say here is, oh yes, so let's move on and look. Remember the soft and fuzzy Ivan IV? So this is a completely different face of a Russian czar. So Peter the Great, first of all, does something that unthinkable. He moves capital from Moscow, which is very old time, and in built himself a new city on the Finland Gulf, where I was born much later. So this is St. Petersburg. This is the very first city in the country to have a non-Russian name. Well, I mean, obviously after the Vikings. So who knows what is Russian anymore? Okay, so look. So the sketch on the bottom right is the sketch of St. Petersburg as it was in the middle of 1700s. And on the left is the beautiful palace that Catherine the Great built. And of course, Catherine the Great was the granddaughter of Peter the Great. So you see, this looks completely different. And French becomes the official language very, very quickly. With Catherine, who was just obsessed with everything French. But what I would like to do, where is that recording, Raul, of Concerto? Yes. Praise the Lord.
On the next slide.
Yeah.
Is it the Praise the Lord?
No, actually, sorry. Let's go, let's play Vasily Titov Glory, which is on the next slide.
So,
So it's called partesni concert or partes concerto, parts, right? And so the melodies are still just so beautifully Russian. But of course, you can see the texture and the style of it is so different. So these are the Italian masters that you see there. Oops, can we go one up? Yeah, this one, the Italian period. So the Italian period, as I said, begins with all these composers being brought from Western Europe. And of course, most of them are from Italy, Galuppi, Sarti, Paisiello, Cimarosa. And these are the guys who write the first operas for Russia. They're still in Italian and they're still Italian operas, but they are now a part of Russian culture. First composers are sent to Italy to be trained also, or they're trained by these wonderful masters right there in Russia. And so the composer that you most probably know about, a composer called Bartnyansky, we would say the first composer who received that training in the Western Europe and then came back and truly changed the way Russian music, liturgical music sounded and then how it was being performed. So everything that he learned to do, he spent quite a few years in Italy, and he learned to write for instruments, which is not something that you can learn in Russia because instruments are really not allowed. There are still no orchestras. So he went to the court chapel, to the Russian Imperial court chapel, and was a singer, boy singer there. And he became Empress Elizabeth's favorite choir boy, one of her favorite choir boys. And she was, of course, the daughter of Peter the Great. Started composition with Galuppi in 1769, and then also was sent by Catherine the Great, the next Tsarina, to further his studies there. And when he came back, he became also the director of the Capella, the first Russian-born director of the Capella. And important moment, he expanded the Capella from that 27 men, which already were, you know, there was additional boys to that, so most probably was somewhere around 40 by then. He expanded the Capella to 108 singers, right? Still boys and men. And this is also important that he's the first one to conduct Messiah, Mozart's Requiem, Haydn's Creations. So which means that already at that time, there were orchestras in Russia. So the one that you heard was also by Titov, that glory. Also a wonderful composer. Check both of them out on Musica Russica site, because there are quite a few compositions by them. So he was Bach contemporary, born in 1650, and served in the choir of Tsar's singing clerics, which is the same thing, those 27 men in the beginning, and was one of the most gifted composers of his time. He worked primarily in Moscow, which means before Bartnyansky was already in St. Petersburg. And he wrote 200 sacred music compositions, out of them 100 concerti. So, and those concerti are just amazing. You know, I've done now so many of them as part of programs, again, with Chanticleer and Houston Chamber Choir, with professional choirs and BBC singers. They are fantastic, because they don't require that heavy Russian sound. They are so transparent in their texture, and they also let you truly feature your soloists in light music, especially if you have a college choir, or even if you have a very good high school choir. They really are like the Italian concerti, but just in old church Slavonic, which you can do. And so listen to this. So his compositions range for chamber ensembles to work for 8, 12, 16, and sometimes 24 voices. And no fewer of them are choral concerto. So do check it out. There are great recordings now. And then again, Musica Russica prints a lot of them too. Okay, and so let's also hear, we haven't played this Bartnyansky concerto, Praise the Lord. Bartnyansky in Old Church Slavonic. Now I want you to hear Bartnyansky concerto that is translated, the text translated into English. So I was kind of staying away from translation, from translated Russian works for a long time until I decided to perform the next, the Let Our God Arise. Right, yes. And I performed it, I programmed it for Seraphic Fire last year. And the singer said, well, do you think we could just try to do it in English since the score had the English translation? And I said, well, why not? Why not? And so we did it. It actually, I liked it. I really liked it. That was a changing point of my career, I swear. But I once we listened to it in English, I'm going to tell you what we need to do careful, very carefully when we translate. Okay, let's hear it. Let our God arise.
Let God arise, and let his enemies be scattered, and let his enemies, and let his enemies be scattered, be scattered.
This recording, I honestly don't even know what this recording is. It's on Musica Russica side. It's a little bit affected. All of this in and out, it's a little bit affected. It really shouldn't be like that. But what is also interesting is that Old Church Slavonic, just like Russian, just like so many Slavic languages, has so many consonants. And so what you learn to do when you sing is to make them super quick and very, 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 very light. And so when you overdo articulation in English, when you sing this music, it becomes just a little bit too punctuated. Let the man, as the vanishes, I can't remember the words, but let the vanish, let the vanish. It kind of breaks the melody, it clips it a little bit. So I would not overdo those consonants so much, just because it then becomes, it takes away that beautiful line of a Russian melody. But I still think it can work, and that is so much easier to learn. Okay, let's move on. All right, well, that whole Italian period is coming to an end because the Germans are coming too. So court composer Bartnyansky dies, and with him dies this whole Italianate era. And Lvov, who comes to replace him, is a student of Schumann and Mendelssohn. And so we get into this simplified choral writing in four parts. So why don't we listen to Kedrov or Chenash that most of you know? They come very different writing. So that's very different already. And another important thing just happens here is that the boys are now replaced by women. And it actually wasn't a artistic decision. It's just it was too expensive to keep them. And then they were saying that also there was a lot of drinking, I don't know. So the women supposedly came to save the day. Now, why was the Tchaikovsky's 1879 publication of Liturgy of St. John's Chrysostom, what was it controversial? Because he was first non-religious, not trained in religious music composer to write a religious composition. And so that he begins that whole stream of music written by classically trained composers, academically trained composers, who decided to write in religious music, even though this religious music would never be performed in the church because it was not written by a special composer. Okay, so let's move on. This is after the war with Napoleon, the French wars. And so nationalism in the country is growing very, very strong. So we're kind of getting over this whole fascination with France, Italy, and Germany. Now it's a nationalistic movement. The Mighty Five, as you know, a very, very strong community of composers, begins their work to sort of bring more Russian sounding music into everything. And the second most important thing that we're now having composers that are writing secular music. And they are being trained in the two first composers established by two phenomenally brilliant pianists, brothers, Anton Rubinstein and Nikolai Rubinstein. They established two conservatories, one in 62 in St. Petersburg, which I was a student at, so it's really incredible, and then in Moscow. If we move on, and let's talk about secular choral music. And that's one of the reasons I try to program as much secular music when I go guest conduct as possible. Because it's, for the most part, when people think of Russian music, they think of Rachmaninoff Vespers, Rachmaninoff All Night Vigil. And that's really sad. it's a fantastic piece, but there is so much more. And there is more than, so when people say, we would like you to program Russian music, usually it means Chesnokov, who Kallistratov, you know, all of these composers that wrote in this Rachmaninoff sounding style. So what I would like you to hear, let's just go to the sound right away and you will see what I mean. This is such a light that's very much like a music played in salons of nobility. And very often these are just four-part songs to be sung by quartets. Venetian's Night.
Oh.
lovely. Oh my gosh, this is so beautiful. This is the music that I grew up singing, because, you know, when I went to school, religious music was still not allowed. So I received the highest degree from the conservatory in St. Petersburg without ever studying Russian liturgical music, which I all studied later when I became a singer in professional choir. But so where were we? Yes, right here. So now you notice the basso profundo there, the octavist. It's not in the music at all, not at all. So why is it there? Well, they're called octavists, right? Which means that they sing everything that the bass sing, but an octave below. So this choir, it's a professional choir that recorded it. They have on staff a basso profundo. So even in the piece that is completely not needed, they will still put it in just to say, we got a basso profundo and we're going to use him. So it's a quartet. It should be performed by quartet. And I don't know how many households they have their own basso profundo that they can invite, you know, after the dinner to add a few really low notes. But anyways, so look at this. Again, this represented beautifully in Musica Russica. Look for this music that where you will look at, you will see the entire score and there's never divisi. It's beautiful. Glinka, Balakirev, Borodin, Dargamishsky, say that 5 times fast, Tchaikovsky, Lyadov, QE, Kalinnikov, Rimsky-Korsakov, Rachmaninoff, they all wrote this beautiful light composition for concerts and just for people getting together. All right, now this is what's called the golden age of Russian sacred music when they went back to monody. They decided to strip all of the layers that came on the Italian and the German. They decided, okay, let's go and see what this old Znamenny chant used to be like, modality, and see how much it was actually connected to the folk tradition. Again, this is that nationalism time when they look for everything Russian. And of course, if you ever seen pictures of Leo Tolstoy, this is where he took off the regular clothes that you would wear at court, and he put this sort of like a kaftan, a robe that regular people, the peasants would wear. Okay, so a new body of Russian music was created for liturgy and for concert stage. It's again important. So Rachmaninoff, when he was writing his All Night Vigil, I'm sure most of you know that he was writing this as an exercise. It was not a religious piece, because in order for a piece to be performed in a religious ceremony, everything has to be a harmonization of a chant, of existing chant from the Book of Chants. He wrote 6 of the chants himself out of 15. And so that way, it was apparent that it's an exercise. He wanted to try himself because he was not a religious person, but he really adored the sound of religious Russian religious music. And what happens here, so the choir, remember that the choir is 108 people and sometimes was 120 people. That's why when you look at the music of Smolensky, Chesnokov and Konstalsky, sorry, I called him something else before, but that you see incredible divisi. Well, there were 120 professional singers. Of course there were divisi, right? And then, and so now when I you know, travel around the world and I see people, conductors take pieces from that period and they give it to their, you know, 40 voice high school choir. And I go, well, of course it's not sounding right because you just simply don't have enough bulk to it. So it sounded very, very big. It's supposed to be sounding very big. So one of the difficulties of this, I mean, this is again, beautiful music. Do it if you have the forces, but you have to have lots of basses, you have to have very low altos. And most importantly, you have to have a choir mature enough physically that can sing very loud, very slow for a long time, or very, very soft, very slow, you know, in 120 voices, something like that. So Rachmaninoff to this day, and I agree with that, considered to be the crowning masterpiece of the Moscow school. And then, so the choral series, what's important about that is that they decided that church music should be performed on concert stage. which is very, very new. It was not allowed before. And so through this Lenten concerts, lots of pieces got to be performed in concert hall because all the opera theaters were closed during Lent. And all those incredible singers, you know, like Shalapin, for instance, they had no jobs. And so specifically somebody like Rachmaninoff would write a piece of music that is a religious piece of music, but with a huge solo. Right, like you see, or incredible tenors that Russian opera theater had at the time. So that those phenomenal tenor solos in Rachmaninoff's All Night Vigil, there was an opera singer singing it. Okay, so if we move on, and yeah, I'm not going to play Bless the Lord because that's Rachmaninoff, everybody knows. Let's move on to choral orchestral work. So we have not, I'm trying to stay away from accompanied works just because it's just such a different genre. But I wanted to let you know there was quite a lot written at the time. And then if you ever interested in exploring music, the Tchaikovsky's cantata Moscow, called Moscow commission for some Moscow anniversary. It's a very, very good music. So again, when you deal with something that, like the spring and the bells, you're not in old church Slavonic anymore. You are in Russian. And not that it's, you know, it's much easier Russian compared to church Slavonic, but it's much less consonants. Even Russians, we still have our tongues, you know, twisted in knots when we sing in old church Slavonic. There are just too many consonants, I tell you. I constantly try to buy a vowel for those words. Okay, cantata Daneev, it's unknown, practically unknown in the West. Joan of Damascus, phenomenal piece of music. And Daneev was a student of Tchaikovsky, phenomenal piece. And that's one of my hopes that someday we will publish it here. Cantata Spring, also unknown here, but the score actually exists. And of course, the bells, unbelievable piece. But I wanted to play the bells, most probably people know, but how about we play a little bit of John of Damascus? No, that's the bells. Did I give you the wrong? That's the bells. Could it be switched? Could it be the...
I think both are the bells. I'm so sorry, Elena.
Oh, no. It's my mistake. Okay. That's all right. Let's not do it then. Okay. Now, gosh, I am so... Let's skip the 20th century. Let's go to Music for the Revolution. So what I would like to tell you about this, So imagine all of these composers, these brilliant composers. Now, they cannot write religious music anymore, and they cannot write music that is really kind of singing in their hearts. They have to create music for the revolution. This new power came, and that new power says, we need music that would be, because Russians are so attached to musical culture. Give us music that will let us glorify the revolution. And people like Shostakovich, who at the, you know, at the time of revolution, he was this prodigy, very, very young person, was writing a lot of, I wouldn't say avant-garde music, but very modern music. And then so he, like so many others, he has to tune his creativity to sort of serve the power. And he still, and the reason I'm mentioning all of this is because so often music of the Soviet period is not looked at because it was supposedly, you know, it's the wrong message. But listen to this beautiful Shostakovich's Ballad of Two Soldiers that was written, I think it's in the 40s or something. I'm sorry, I cannot remember. How beautiful it is. And the words are actually not so bad. It's a fugue.
Mm-hmm.
So again, so much music is written a cappella. And it's an interesting situation because they decided that orchestras is really not what's going to reach to the people. It has to be singing, because Russian singing, whether it's in church or in folk, practically is all a cappella. So they decided that the composed music has to be a cappella mostly too. And so there are fantastic sets of a cappella compositions were created at that time. And the chorus becomes the favorite instrument of the party. Very interesting. And so much is thrown into growing a new population, new specialists in the choral field. So there's just choral singing and choral culture was incredibly supported. So that's why, you know, the first representative of Russia in the West was the Red Army Chorus. If you think about it, that's before ballet came over. I mean, revolution, after the revolution. So regional cappellas are everywhere. People are, lots of singers employed, lots of conductors needed. And of course, Russian schools for children, music school for children are also everywhere. It's really fantastic. And it's practically free for everybody. So there's quite a few composers that came out of the, after Stalin, you know, they all were born during Stalin's era, but they actually became, you know, known after he died. And this is, of course, Alfred Schnittke, Sofia Gubaldulna, Georgi Sviridov, Tisatnikov, Gavrilin, Rodion Shidrin, Gea Kancheli, a Georgian composer, Aram Khachaturian, of course, from Armenia, and Valentin Martinov. Now, so again, if I just can focus this lots of information about that time. So don't throw the baby with the water, right? There was a lot of, you know, for instance, Shostakovich wrote openly praising Stalin poem, big orchestral piece called Song of the Forest. And that was for Stalin's birthday, right? The music itself, we don't know what the words are. It's brilliant music, but it wasn't his choice. He was writing music literally, you know, you die, you write this piece and you live and your family lives. You don't write it, then you die in the camps. So it's just really, it's a very bizarre time where you are a genius and you can write phenomenal music, but you have to put words to it that suit the party and the brutal, you know, regime at the time. So that is still something that I would like to very much bring into the West. Again, lots of music is being written for choir, and these composers really need to be. And lots of light music is being written. So let's hear a little bit of this Mary by Sviridov, a gorgeous piece. That's of course from the Pushkin's Breath. Several of those vignettes on Pushkin's text, and they're just so delightful. Again, I've done it many, many times with choirs here in the US and in Europe, and it's just wonderful. All right, well, we continue struggling in my wonderful country, full of Soviet Union, and what does it bring? It brings religion back. So religion is now allowed, a huge comeback. New artistic freedoms, but all of those government supported ballet theaters and, you know, concert orchestras, they're starting to struggle because the country is bankrupt. There is no money. That's where we lose lots of great musicians to the West, because they now can go. Remember, the country was behind the Iron Curtain for a long, long, long time. We just really had no information and we couldn't get out. Music publishing, see, so composers did not own their music. Everything was owned by the government. And when the government is no longer, right? So who owns the music? And this still, to this day, a problem to get music published in the West, but we're working on this. But what I would like you to hear is one of the pieces that Sviridov, our patriarch of choral music, he wrote. So for many, many years, he was writing, as he was writing those beautiful vignettes and big, big, huge compositions that were praising Soviet Union, he also wrote an incredible number of sacred compositions that nobody ever saw. And it only after the fall of communism that we now discovered this composition. So see, listen how profound this is. That are developing in such a slow, beautiful pace. It's just amazing. You can still hear that Moscow school in his writing, that the Moscow school of Rachmaninoff and Chesnokov, it's still there. And by the way, you don't have to sing it so slow. There are reasons that it's done so slow in Russia. First of all, because of the acoustics, and secondly, because the choirs are big. You can, whatever you want to do. But if you have smaller, number of people, you can move it along a little bit more. And then finally, I would like to, I know I'm over time, but finally, I would like to tell you of something that has been really labor of love for me. Composer Valery Gavrilin, who died in 1999, is a phenomenal, phenomenal, wonderful composer who wrote a lot for movies, but also composed a lot of music, as many of his people of his time, which is, you know, people who are composing in the 60s and 80s, 60s and 70s, he wrote music with this village feel. So kind of like going back into the folk, presenting the folk of now. And it was, what's the word? It was safe to write that, and you could use this as a fable language, you know. Second, there's always a second layer of meaning. So for instance, sounds of bells for Russians means sort of, you know, God's voice. So for instance, if you put bells, imitation of bells into choral music, then it's sort of like it's a religious, it's a little bit of a religious note there, right? You're not saying God, but you're going, din dong bell, and everybody knows, okay, he's thinking religion, he's thinking God. And so it's this piece is, by its popularity, it's the same as the Carmina Burana in the United States. Every choir sings it. And I think it's a tremendous, tremendous piece to really understand and love Russian choral music. And I have taken several years, but I'm now in my number 9 out of the 15 movements. And it is a cappella. It's very cheap to put on. It's one oboe and 2 percussionists, and that's all it is. And it can be also staged, but I would like you to hear a bit of this music. So there are several different genres of folk music here, but let's start with the tongue twisters. part of this song and many others in the set, there's a lot of ding dong, ding dong. So usually it's, you can even do this, all of the words you can do with the soloist. And that then is less Russian to learn. And then also another one, let's hear the evening music. This is no words at all. This is just a very contemplative piece that literally imitates Russian church bells. Let's hear the soul rejoicing. So this is a story of a Russian Robin Hood, redemption. This is the robber, highway robber. Yeah, you should have heard, was it 2014, Texas All State? Man, I did quite a few pieces from Chimes, and it was incredible. It can be done, and it gives a phenomenal sense of understanding Russian music. Well, listen, I think I am at the end of my presentation. And what I wanted to show you is several books that I actually use a lot in my presentations, and I consider them really important volumes that give you great idea of Russian religious music, and not only religious music. And then some composers that I still wanted to give you the names, and they can find them through Sikorsky Music Publishing in Germany. Well, I don't know. This was very fast. And the good thing is that the presentation is yours and you can remember things just by looking at the at my slides that are so beautifully done, by the way, by Raul. My presentation looked like a third grader's presentation and he made it all pretty. So thank you so much. And if you have any questions, I'm here and would love to hear your thoughts and questions.
Great. Thank you so much, Elena, for sharing your insight. Like she said, we'll now transition into the Q&A session. So please remember to submit your questions using the Q&A button found in your toolbar. Priority will be given to questions about today's topic. And questions that are submitted to the chat, they will not be considered. So our first question comes from Ryan Fellman, who asks, in terms of listening to Russian choral music, what are some of your favorite choirs to hear singing this type of music to get, you know, more familiar with the literature?
Yeah. Well, actually, I would say that Polyanskyi's choir or Moscow Chamber Choir are my two Russian favorites. There are quite a few younger choirs that I don't know very well yet, but these two are very established and, you know, they really do a good job. Russian choirs very often overdo it on the sound because our capellas are usually very, very big, up to 100 people. And then sometimes they make music sound too heavy. So Polyansky is good, and so is Minin with his Moscow Chamber Choir. I also like Estonian Chamber Choir and Latvian Chamber Choir. They do Russian music exceptionally well because they don't pour all of this Russian. Too much passion sometimes leads to a bit of a compromised intonation. But the people in the Baltic Republics do it very well because they all speak still Russian.
Great, thank you. I apologize if I mispronounce any names. This one comes from Mila, who says, thank you very much for this webinar, and asks if you could share what was the most difficult part for singers to adopt what was in the lyrics, the melodies and constructions, which is really, you know, different from what people in the US use.
Yes. Well, thank you for asking this question. It's very important. So by now I have done so much as Russian music with people who don't speak Russian, especially speaking the Germanic languages. So the hardest thing is, even for professionals, is the ahs and the ohs and the oohs. They're just a little bit too shallow. So very often it's an Italian ah, and it doesn't work for Russian music. So you really have to be very diligent. It's not that you can't do it, but you have to stick with it. Bogorodice or Slava, so the ahs. The second thing is, in Russian language, we don't have short vowels. They're all long, which means that you don't close on the consonant. You don't start closing the vowel as you see the consonant coming up. And so it's prolonging, it's really making the vowel as long as possible, not closing the mouth. That is the two. And then of course the consonants, the T's, that they cannot be T, they have to be the very, very dental. So that's two. And then the last thing, somehow we learned so quickly as children how to do staggered breathing. And it's because the lines are so long, and it's, you have to really, again, commit to stagger breathing, not breathe together. And sometimes you just have to, if you're not a big choir, sometimes you just have to assign who breathes there. So the line sounds very intact.
Thank you. Mila has a second part to their question. And this is just regarding general feedback from audiences where you've gone to conduct Russian music. What is their impression after leaving, hearing something they may not normally hear on a regular basis? How is the music received?
Usually incredibly warmly. But I have to say, you have to be careful, you know, not to overload, right? Because when you, for instance, if you decide to perform the entire Rachmaninoff All Night Vigil, it's a long piece. It's you know, it's 80 minutes, and so much of it is slow. So you have to be careful. So the audience will have to be prepared. That's one thing. And secondly, when I do my programs, I like to put music that sounds differently. You know, for instance, I would do some of the Russian Baroque, and I will definitely do the chant, and then some lighter music and some music by Gavrilian, things like that. But I think loading an entire program with Russian liturgical music, it's asking your audience for a lot of attention. So again, knowing your ensemble, knowing your audience, and of course knowing your where you're going to perform it as far as the acoustics are concerned is important. But otherwise, I've never heard anybody say, oh, you know, I didn't like it, it's not my music. Never happened.
Thank you. Resources for Russian diction. Anything that you could in particular recommend?
Well, as you know, Musica Russica has pronunciation guide for practically every single piece. If you go on Musica Russica, you click on the piece, and immediately next to it, there will be a pronunciation guide.
Great.
But don't ask people who, you know, speak Russian to come and teach you Old Church Slavonic. They wouldn't even know how to pronounce it, because it's pronounced quite differently from Russian.
Thank you. One viewer asks about any young emerging composers that are coming up at this time that we should be aware of from Russia.
Well, you know, there are quite a few, and I'm sorry I didn't put this into my program, but if you're really interested, I wouldn't say any of them actually are published. I have been trying to bring Russian composers here, and I am working on this. So if this is something that seriously interests you, I would suggest just come directly to me, and I'll point you. There's a lot of composers working for young and amateur choirs. This sort of
lovely. Thank you. We have a few minutes more, Elena. Is there anything else that you would like to expand upon? Any of the topics that we've covered today? Anything that you thought maybe I could go back and talk about this just a little bit more in the presentation before we close today?
Well, I guess, I don't know if I want to expand on anything I've said, except for say again, that whenever I ask my colleagues why they're not performing more Russian music, I think it's a combination of the language scares me, or, you know, the scores demand so much sound, or, you know, there's so much divisi. And what I would, again, say, remember, Russian music has been so different through the centuries, and there were compositions that were much lighter and still very beautiful and still very Russian, but they don't demand such huge sound. Just explore musica russica, you know, God bless them, they still remain the best resource for everything. But I also would like to be a resource, and people always can come to me and ask for help. And course, if you would like to put a Russian program together and would like to ask me for any kind of involvement, whether conducting or coaching or thing like that, I'm always very happy to do that.
Great. We had a couple more come in.
Okay.
Where can we find scores for the line singing that we demonstrated earlier? Do those exist?
Oh, yeah, they exist. They mostly exist in Russian resources for church singing. And if somebody's really, I don't think there has ever been any published in the West, but if somebody's really interested, I can find it for them.
Great. And our last one that we'll close with today asks if you are able to speak on any specific resources about learning this style of chant, since it is often the foundation of much of this music.
Again, lots of resources, but they're all in Russian. I have not looked into any compilation of them, but there is a wonderful choir called Capella Romana. They are, I believe, in Washington or in Oregon, and their conductor is not Russian, but he's a specialist on Orthodox chant, Byzantine chant, and Georgian chant, and the Russian chants. So that, I would say, is the best resource here.
Great, thank you very much. And with that, our colloquium is a wrap, everybody. Please help thanking Elena Sharkova for being with us today. Thank you.
Thank you so much for inviting me. Great to be with you.
Thank you also to all of our colloquium guests, Dr. Anton Armstrong, Dr. Janet Galvan, Dr. Richard Sparks, Maestra Dawala Simmons-Burke, and Elena Sharkova. All of their lectures can be found on our YouTube channel. A heartfelt thank you to our sponsors for Volume 1. If you've enjoyed our content, please consider a small $15 donation to help us start Volume 2 in 2021. Woo-hoo. The donation link is now in the chat and on our Facebook. We grow together. The more we grow, the more you will grow as a learner. And one last special thank you to our viewers. We will see you next summer for Volume 2, where we will partner again with brilliant conductors in new ways to bring you another free lecture series. We will send today's lecture materials in the next colloquium e-blast. There you can also tell us how we did by taking the CCC post-lecture survey, where you'll also have a chance to recommend a conductor you admire for Volume 2 in 2021. For those applying for credit, please don't forget your deadline of August 15th And you can help celebrate the end of Volume 1 by sharing our content on with your friends on Facebook and Instagram at Choral Conductors Colloquium. Finally, I hope you'll use what you learned today to put beauty into our world. To each of you out there, best of luck this year. Be safe, be healthy, and forever be resilient in the face of your obstacles. Thank you for watching, and thank you, Elena. Have a great year, everybody.
Thank you so much for having me. Thank you, everybody.